Hello YouTubers. So in this video I'm going to give you an overview of Doug's Vref5-002. So Doug from Voltage Standard has kindly sent me this 5-volt reference, his most precise 5-volt reference that he sells. He obviously does the smaller devices for doing reference checks on multimeters, where they give more functionality in terms of checking resistance, AC and DC and current. But this is a precision 5-volt reference, which he measures down to, or he gives an accuracy of 0.0025%. Now that is in the same order as my 6.5 digit multimeter from Fluke. So what we're going to do, we're ultimately going to go onto the bench. I'll show you the device and the measurements that I'm getting across two of my meters now, my HP3457A and the Fluke, and then show you now potentially what accuracy and certainty I can go and measure other multimeters. I have also in the process played around with different temperatures. I've put it in the cooler, taken it down to about 7 or 8 degrees Celsius, and then back up, in fact, up to 60 degrees Celsius. I wanted to see the stability of the device under that temperature range to see how it would perform in the lab and whether I needed to keep it in the cooler or whether in hotter weather where I can afford to have it sat out in temperatures of, let's say, 25 to 28 degrees Celsius. Let's get down to the bench and have a closer look at it. Rightio, so here we have the device itself, and I say once we've gone through the specs I'll kind of zoom in and give you a little bit of a closer look. At some point in time we will have a proper closer review. I'm waiting on some other test equipment which again will give me a better ability to better evaluate this, and perhaps then we can consider opening it up, having a look inside and putting on the scope and what have you. But from this is the kind of specs and information on the device. As noted, it's a 5-volt reference, which has got a 0.0025% accuracy or 25 parts per million. It talks about the technology that it uses, the Cirrus Logic VRE305A. I know nothing about that. I would have to do some reading myself to find out a bit more about that. And basically he advertises as being a device that you don't need an oven to keep in or a particular temperature. It is calibrated, he notes, he calibrates them at around 68 degrees Fahrenheit or roughly 18 and a half degrees Celsius. So ideally you should be using it at that temperature, but I'm going to talk about a little bit more about that in a moment. And as I said, he goes and calibrates it on his HP3458A, which is an 8.5 digit meter. He calculates it to within 5 microvolts of 5 volts on his meter. And the reason the 5 microvolts is that potentially you've obviously got some noise coming out of the device in the order of 3 or 4 microvolts. But his device, even if his device is showing almost exactly 5 volts, his accuracy on his HP is 0.0008% or 8 parts per million. So that translates realistically to roughly, give or take, if it's not as far, and it shouldn't be as far out because I know his device is calibrated every year, you're looking at 30 to 45 microvolts. So basically down to the fourth digit. So obviously here on the device you can actually see there's 4 digits, but on his fifth and sixth digit you're looking at 45 microvolts that it could be out. So certainly, as noted on his device here, 5.0000 volts, you can almost take with certainty that's the reference you're getting, which is really nice. It is powered by an external AC adapter, which I've got plugged in. It's actually got a secured screw in so that the AC plug doesn't come out accidentally. Now, as I said, he guarantees that it will be in within 125 microvolts of the 5-volt reference for at least 6 months, and he will then recalibrate it after a year. Now, I say potentially, these devices get better with time because they age, they kind of burn in and they become more stable. So I certainly after a year will send it back to Doug because this is now left on permanently 24/7 so that it remains at the right temperature, and the meters measuring it, which I'll show you in a moment, are also left on. So as you can see, it's in this die cast case. It's got this DC jack, 24 volts, with a securing nut over here so that the DC power can't be pulled out accidentally. I do, as it so happens, because of the thunderstorms here and the power brownouts we get, I have got my kit connected to a UPS for better or worse, so that at least the meters measuring this, which now stay on 24/7, and this device are permanently powered on and should do for a while anyway if there is a minor power failure. I don't have the best leads coming out of it at the moment, but I've done a fair bit of experimentation in terms of understanding the robustness and eliminating noise and issues around the cabling I've got. And again, when we look at the meters, I'll talk about that. It has got an LED obviously indicating that it's switched on, and some neat little feet that it stands on whatever surface you have it on. So it certainly stands there nice and neatly. It does have gold-plated banana sockets on there as well, just to ensure that you do get good contact. Right, so let me turn you around. We'll have a look at the meters measuring it so you can see what they're showing at the moment. Right, so in front of us now, we've got the Fluke 8846A, and we've got the old HP 6.5 digit, which comes from the kind of 80s era. Still a benchmark meter, but certainly the one that Doug has in his hands, the 3458A, is the big brother of this, and it's a big step up because it's an 8.5 digit with a far more accuracy. Now, both of these devices I've got set at running at 100 power line cycles, so it'll display a measurement every just over a second. So every 100 power line cycles, it'll actually display a measurement. But they are both taking hundreds, if not approaching 1,000 in some cases, readings per second. They will then average those to help with rejecting AC hum and noise and other interference. So that's why you'll see, even though we're measuring down to the fifth digit here, they're relatively stable. And you'll note, if you look at these for a while, the HP tends to have a little more flatter on the end digit rather than the Fluke. The Fluke probably has a little better noise rejection and filtering and averaging to give you a little more of a more stable reading. The Hewlett-Packard, I say, goes at about 1,350 readings per second, but that's at 3.5 digits, and the Fluke does 1,000 at 4.5 digits. I'm not sure what they do once you get to 6.5 digits. I haven't found that spec. But I say, their sampling and the noise rejection are helping to provide a stable reading, and the fact now that they've obviously been left on for a long time because they kind of reach a temperature. Now, if you note the readings, they are fortunately, and again, I'm fortunate in the fact that the Fluke was calibrated just over a year ago. It read, according to the Fluke calibration, an absolute 5-volt reference read as 4 and 5 9s on here. So certainly it was only kind of one count out with what it can display here. My Hewlett-Packard, I know it was sent to calibration, it was within spec, but I don't have the information. But they are certainly not far off from each other, which is nice. So at least I have 2 meters, obviously from different eras, and they've been got other different calibration labs, and they are not far off from one another. Often these two will be within 2 counts of each other, 2 to 5 counts. And so that gives me far more confidence in the level of reading I can go down to. Previously, I will have mentioned that I could only with perhaps certainty go down to 3 digits, because once you include the kind of error from the actual taking the reading to the accuracy of the meter, you kind of down to 3 digits. But now that I've got this setup and I've obviously got the averaging going and cross-reference, it looks like I can go down to a certainty to 4, which is great, because that then verifies the reference that Doug gives me, and I can now do measurements on other devices. So case in point, I know there are a few folk who like even asking like the Unity UT61E, which is a 22,000 count meter, whether that was in spec and whether it had drifted. And now all I need to do with this, I've got it set up so I can obviously switch it on to its DC volts. I then have two jacks which I can leave out ready to plug any meter into. They are shielded, so there's no risk of obviously shorting the reference because you don't want to do that. And as an example, if I then plug the that in, because the concern was would this drift over time and being shipped so far, we can actually see the old Unity is only four counts out. It's obviously only going down to three digits, but nonetheless, it's only four counts out. I've got the probes in the wrong way, hence why it's showing a negative, but nonetheless, four counts out. Right, and next we have my old Fluke 287, which has obviously taken some abuse of being converted to be runoff super or hybrid capacitors and has had a DC plug inserted into it. And Mehdi said, you know, it would probably mess up the calibration. However, again, seeing now as certainly for at 50,000 count and going down to four places for 5 volts, I can with reason now with fairly good confidence say that this meter is well within its spec. It's only two counts out. Obviously, again, the important thing to note here is that leaving these meters on for a while is important to get the best. If you are going down to kind of low levels and doing measurements, you need to have the meters left on for a little while. Right, and again, so this meter, the amp probe AM160A, was the one that I calibrated back in South Africa. And I calibrated it against one of Doug's other references. And again, certainly you can see down to its default 50,000 count, it is spot on, so no complaints with it there. But of course this, if I switch a button, goes up to 500,000 or 500,000 count. And we can see it's a few digits out there, and in comparison with the meters, with the Fluke, if I just spin up quickly, and have the Fluke in the background on as well, you'll see it's actually, if not exactly on, maybe one or two counts out from the Fluke. Now obviously there's going to be a bit more flutter on this device because it's not averaging. There's potentially any noise picked up from the leads or the actual analog to digital converter inside it would potentially show up as noise, or the way the timing in the device can cause issues. So it's certainly doing very well to be giving a measurement down to this level. Now I will insert a little shot of when I did my testing. What I did when I cooled these devices, I noted that it drifted higher from 5 volts, not too much higher. I've got those figures on the spreadsheet. But when I heated them up to close to 60 degrees, now when I say heated, so that would be the reference I had in my little wine cooler with a blower on it. Internally, it wouldn't have been at 60 degrees, but certainly the ambient temperature inside the cooler, and I let it sit for a while, was at 60, so I suppose it might have been at 50 or 55. That then drew the value closer to 5 volts according to my readings. I say not necessarily what it was calibrated at. And I've got a shot where literally I had all three devices measuring and all of them were showing precisely 5 volts down to 5 places for the actual device. But that whole test at least gave me confidence that I can quite happily have this out on the bench in temperatures ranging from, let's say, its calibration temperature of around 18 degrees right up to 28 degrees, and it should certainly, I should with confidence be able to go down to the 4 digits. But there'll be a little, with as I said, I'm waiting on some equipment. We're going to do some interesting testing in the weeks to come on that. Right then, so I hope you might have found that of interest. I know for the most part not many people are going to go and purchase a device like that. I just certainly find that area of electronics interesting, seeing how precise one can be with taking measurements, and the science and the challenges of trying to do that accurately and trying to maintain a reference so that you've got some reasonable confidence of going back to something so that you can vet the tools and measurement equipment that you've got. So say, in the weeks to come, I'm hopefully going to have a very interesting piece of kit arrive that I've been kind of lusting after for quite a while. And that certainly will then act as a really nice cross-reference to tools like that. But anyway, thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.